my name's Richard Felix, and I'm going to take you on a tour of the haunted Northeast. Some of the region's best and spookiest stories come from the remotest part of the Northeast, the border strongholds. And during the video, we'll be taking you to one of the most haunted castles in England. Some of the stories you'll hear are to do with murders, suicides, battles, and accidents. We'll be seeing real entities, spirits that are trapped on this earth for whatever reason. Either they're still wanting to haunt the place because they loved it, or because of the tragic circumstances of their death. Other stories we'll be hearing, I think, are actually only recordings, again to do with tragic, premature death. Their time hadn't come, and I believe that the energy used by the body, the electronic impulses given off by the brain moments before death, can be so immense that that event just before death can actually be recorded into the fabric of the building. The stone, the bricks, the woodwork, possibly even the soil. And then for some reason, either the anniversary of that death or because the atmosphere is similar, certain gifted people see a reenactment, a recording of that event happening again. But what better place to start this tour of the Northeast than here, in front of the Angel of the North, the icon of the Northeast. Because you must remember that even the devil was a fallen angel. So settle back, turn down the lights, give me your full attention, and let me take you on a tour, a haunted tour, of the Northeast. I'm in the middle of Newcastle, standing in front of the Cathedral Church of St. Nicholas. Most of it dates back to the 14th and 15th century, but there is actually a very small part inside that goes back as far as 1175. During the English Civil War in 1644, a lot of Scots prisoners were captured and held imprisoned here at Newcastle. And the Scots came down and threatened to blow up the cathedral with their cannons. So the mayor of Newcastle moved all the Scots prisoners into the lantern tower of the cathedral, thus saving the cathedral for the present day. Now, there are not many stories, to be quite honest with you, genuine stories, about graveyards, churches and cathedrals. But Newcastle Cathedral has got its own ghost, the ghost of a knight in armour. So let's go inside and have a look. I'm in the beautiful old cathedral of St. Nicholas in the centre of Newcastle, and would you believe they've got a ghost? They've got the ghost of a knight in armour that has been seen on many occasions around this area of the cathedral. He's supposed to emanate from a tomb which is just down here. This is the tomb of a knight from the early part of the 14th century. He's supposed to have been either killed during the Crusades and his body brought back, or he actually died and was just buried here. No one is sure. But actually, there's an inscription here that says, "Effigy of an unknown knight, not later than 1325. And apparently, this stone, this effigy, was going to be thrown out of the cathedral. But someone, and it says here, the parish clerk, Mr. Fisher, stopped this actually happening. Now, on frequent occasions, people have heard the clanking of armour in and around this area of the church, of the cathedral, and an American lady taking a photograph here, and she got it home, actually noticed that there was a faint figure, the figure of a knight, standing in this area of the cathedral. Had she, of course, seen the knight when she was taking the photograph, she said she would have taken many more pictures. She would have zoomed in on it. She didn't see it. It was only after she got home and she had the photograph developed. Why he haunts this place? No one's sure. Perhaps it's because he's keeping a weather eye on his effigy to make sure that nobody in the future decides to throw this out of the cathedral here at Newcastle. I'm in the little village of Washington. Not Washington, America. Washington, County Durham. And behind me is the old original Washington Hall, which goes back to the time of the Saxons. And of course, it was the de Wessington family, which became Washington, that were the ancestors of no less than George Washington, of American War of Independence fame. And we've just had a little negotiation with someone from the hall, and they're very kindly going to open it up and take us inside. And it's got a ghost, otherwise we wouldn't be here. So why don't you join me? Let's go inside and have a look at Washington Hall. I'm actually standing inside Washington Old Hall. There is a part of the building that goes back to Saxon times, to 973. And the ghost story to do with this place is of yet another grey lady that has been seen wandering around the hall on many occasions. Sometimes she's been seen in this room, and sometimes on the landing upstairs. Some people have reported seeing her walking along with her head bent, weeping. She's been seen by many visitors at the hall, visitors that have come back down to the reception and said, "Who was that grey lady that we saw wandering along the landing?" A lot of children see the grey lady, and of course, children are very susceptible to seeing ghosts. I believe that their mind is much clearer than ours. There's a lot less in their minds, if you like, than what we've crammed into our minds as we get older. And they still have the power, if you like, the old powers, the old senses that we used to have. And on frequent occasions, people have come down and said, "There's a grey lady in one of the rooms upstairs." And they say that she resembles very much one of the pictures here in this room. And of course, up here is a rather charming picture, not exactly of a grey lady, but who knows, could this be a painting of the Grey Lady of Washington Hall? This property originally belonged to William de Hartburn, who had acquired the village of Washington, which of course is now referred to, is called Washington. Their coat of arms was a shield with two bars and three stars, which of course was adopted as the Stars and Stripes, the American flag. Well, we were just literally leaving Washington Old Hall, and the lady that very kindly let us in shouted to me and said, "If you want more ghost stories, then we've actually got the gentleman here that runs the blacksmith's table, and he's got ghost stories, so Here we are, Paul, outside your premises, and you have got ghosts, yeah?
Oh, absolutely. We have a number of ghosts. We have a very famous one called Robert Hazlitt, who I'll come back to briefly.
Yeah.
He's the one that everyone seems to know about, who was the highwayman.
Yeah.
But a little bit of history about the building, first of all. The building is thought to be over 400 years old, and it was initially built to take care of the horses and the related activity belonging to relating to the Washington estate,
yeah.
George Washington's predecessors, along at the Old Hall. So the building's been here for over 400 years, during which time it's seen a lot of change in Washington. Washington has gone from a small little hamlet into now a thriving, what's called a new town, with population well over 80,000 people.
Wow.
So the building stood in the center of all this and watched all this happening. Mm. And in fact, one of the events which did occur in 1676 was the drowning to death of an alleged local witch by the name of Jane Atkinson. Now, just across the green outside here from the restaurant, you'll see an old, it's a cross relating to, it's a tribute to
Cenotaph, sort of thing, yep.
Now, in this particular site in this area, there used to be a village pond.
Right.
And in 1676, so the stories go, the local farmers were having difficulty with their crops. Somebody, of course, had to be blamed.
Yep.
So a lady by the name of Jane Atkinson was actually dragged out. I think she owned a cat.
Exactly, that's enough.
Of course.
She may have had a wart on her nose as well. Been left-handed.
She was accused of being a witch. And, of course, in those days, they were ducked on three occasions.
Yes.
And there was no winning, because if you drowned, it was tough. And if you didn't drown, you were a witch.
And they hanged you. Yeah, exactly.
So, unfortunately, poor old Jane was ducked to death, more or less on the site of where the village cross is now.
Right.
That was a lot of years ago. So the building has been here and witnessed all that.
Of course, it's close enough to, yeah.
Of course. So the layout of the village has been very, very similar. There's been a crossroads here for hundreds of years. And lots of people have driven past, either in the motor cars or prior to that, of course, horse-drawn carriages,
yeah,
and walked past. But one of the major events which occurred in the restaurant's history, or the building's history, was in 1770, when Robert Hazlitt, the highwayman, was captured on the premises.
Actually, inside the blacksmith.
He entered the bar, which is now our cocktail bar, and he was actually captured in the cocktail
bar.
Can
we go and have a look?
Of course we can.
Fantastic.
This was the...
So what was he doing? Obviously, he was having his horse...
Well,
shod or,
I mean,
or
what I tend
to... Oh, blimey, this is a bit
it's
good.
Nice and,
isn't it lovely?
Lovely, romantic.
Yeah, just a bit.
Atmospheric.
Yeah.
I'll take you into a little cocktail bar.
Yep.
And this is the area in which Hazlitt was captured.
Yes.
And I'll just explain what occurred. As we come through here, you can actually see on the wall, this is the original hitching reel. Along
yes.
the wall here.
Yes.
And the wall behind us, which is at the back of our bar, used to be a big open area whereby the horses would come in here. They'd be tethered on the hitching rail.
I see.
And the blacksmith of the day would go backwards and forwards and hit the shoes and fit
working
the
on them while
here.
The horses were here. Yeah.
Now, this guy by the name of Robert Hazlitt was quite a regular customer in this particular smithy.
Yes.
Reason being, if you're a bank robber, you'd want to have a nice fast motor car.
Yeah, good tyres, good wheels, but in...
If you were a highwayman, you kept your horse in good nick.
Of course.
And so, of course, Hazlitt was a regular customer at this particular smithy. One day in 1770, Hazlitt robbed a coach.
A mail coach, or stagecoach,
At Reckington, which is 2 or 3 miles up the road.
Mm.
And that particular robbery was witnessed by someone described as a postboy.
Yes.
And a week or so afterwards, the young postboy was in the village delivering mail, and he noticed a very unusual horse, because this highwayman, Hazlitt, his horse, which I've always thought was a bit strange, you know, I mean, if you're going to do a bank job, don't do it in a bright red Ferrari, you know, mix it with the background. But he had a very distinctive horse,
right.
And the postboy saw the horse in here, tethered in here, being shod. He immediately ran to the local police station, which in those days was in Gateshead.
Right.
So this boy was a good runner.
Yeah.
And alerted the police, and the police came back and spoke to the blacksmith of the day. The blacksmith of the day explained that he was a good customer. He didn't know who he was or what he did, but he was a good customer who brought his horse in on a regular basis, and he was due back later that day to collect the horse. So with the permission of the blacksmith, the police hid in the main body of the restaurant, or what is now the restaurant,
yep,
the main body of the building then. And then when Hazlitt reappeared to collect his horse, it was a case of your nicked old son. And the police came out and sprung a trap on Mr. Hazlitt. The legend, in fact, not the legend, but the fact of his ghost relates to the fact that as he was being dragged away, he cursed the blacksmith for taking
part in his
demise, because
right.
obviously in those days justice was very, very quick,
yeah,
and within a week the guy had been taken away, found guilty and hanged.
Probably at Newcastle, I would
think. At Durham.
Durham, Durham, right.
Yeah. And various legend relates to who the highwayman was. Some people have said Dick Turpin, it wasn't Dick Turpin. Some people say he was actually gibbeted on the corner, on the crossroads in the village. That's untrue as well, to the best of our knowledge. Hazel definitely existed, he was a highwayman, and he was hanged at Durham. However, on a lot of occasions, his ghost has been seen to actually walk in and out of this bar and in and out of the restaurant. He's been witnessed by my wife on a number of occasions, various customers, and people over the last 14 years we've been here have mentioned,
reported seeing him.
You know, seeing Robert Hazlitt. So he's our most famous ghost or spirit, or call him what you will. Yeah. We have a number of other people who visit us on a frequent basis. Just in the front door as we come in, a man stands.
Let's go and have a look.
I'll show you exactly where he stands.
Yeah.
I'll stand there and I'll interpret exactly what he does. He stands, strangely enough, here.
Right.
Not by the window, not by the door, but here.
Yeah.
He faces the door, he faces the wall, and he looks over his left shoulder. And that is all he does.
Right.
Now, we've had mediums in the building, and we have spoken to other spirits, and this man will not communicate. We don't know who he is. There is a blacksmith who sits at the back of what is now the restaurant.
Yes.
And he sits with knees on elbows and watches the proceedings. And we've spoken to him through a medium. And he has told us about Robert Hazlitt, who we knew about anyway.
Yes.
And also about this man here, who he doesn't know who he is. Okay, so we don't know who this person is. Now, on other occasions, customers have seen someone sitting on this table, at the end of this table, like this, just watching the conversation. We have also had experiences of customers seeing a white lady. Mm. One lady appeared, the lady walked through that wall and walked through into the bar and out through the front, which would have been the front door.
Yes.
You know, so a number of experiences have occurred in here. Not just through with myself and my wife, but
other people, customers.
Absolutely. And it's very, very, it has been very, very active. Nothing's happened in the last 9 or 10 months that we're aware of, which is a little disappointing.
Yes, indeed. Yeah, because you know, I mean, it's...
But up until then, the building was very, 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 very active with lots and lots of spirits from different people.
That is... You know? Fantastic. Now, basically, if you want to come and have a meal here and you're looking for a ghostly experience, then this is the table.
Well, any table, really, because people have sat here and eaten with a ghost, if you wish. People have sat in various places in the restaurant and seen things occurring. You know, I can't account for it. I mean, we have our beliefs as to what this is all about.
Yeah.
But certainly we're moving into religious grounds here.
Yes.
People can be offended. So, you know, you just accept these things for what they are.
Yeah. The fact is that this building... has got ghosts.
This building has got a lot of ghosts.
That
and
is
they've been
amazing.
Witnessed by a lot of people, different people, psychics, mediums, gypsy folk have all been in here and have all said that there's something about
and yourselves.
Ghosts. Oh, and ourselves as well. And as I say, we've had a lot of experience here.
That's
and a lot of pleasant experience. And what I say to people is that you should never ever be frightened of ghosts. You know, I mean, the analogy I make is that if you were to walk into a house, into your house, and maybe your wife is there and you weren't expecting her, open the door,
you'd make you jump.
Get a shock.
Correct.
There's a distinct difference between being frightened and being shocked.
Correct.
And ghosts tend to shock you rather than frighten you if you have the right mental approach to it. Yeah. They're only people when all said and done.
Of course, they were alive once and they really didn't do a lot of harm
people
then.
People said to me, why not have the place exercised and get rid of them? Well, I've got no right to do that. They've been here longer than I.
They're an integral part
of
the
life.
Building, your life and your business.
Yeah, we don't mind at all. If they want to pop in, they can pop in.
Paul, that is fantastic.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Cheers, thank you. Have a look around.
Thank you. Cheers. I'm in the middle of Alnwick, northeast England. I found a fantastic old pub called The Cross. The word Alnwick comes from Aln, A-L-N, which is Celtic for bright river, and Wick, which is a Saxon word for homestead or farmstead. It's obviously pronounced Alnwick. It was originally given to the De Vecchi family by William the Conqueror. The cross of the De Vecchi family is still up here on the wall of this pub, which of course is called The Cross. But the family later disappeared and the Percy family took over Alnwick Castle. The huge castle, which we're hopefully going to visit in a few minutes, was a bastion for many, many years against Scottish invasion. There's an incredible story here. As I was looking for the pub earlier, I asked a gentleman in the marketplace could you tell me where the cross is? He said, oh yes, dirty bottles. And I said, yes, that's quite correct. And here, apparently, this part of the pub was originally a wine merchant's. And over 150 years ago, a wine merchant on the inside of the pub was making a display of bottles, wine bottles. He collapsed, presumably with a heart attack, and died. And his wife sealed off the window and left the bottles exactly as they were moments after her husband died. And the legend has it that anyone who disturbs these wine bottles will die. I'm inside the cross now, approaching the back of the window here with the dirty bottles. And are they dirty? There's cobwebs, there's dust, broken glass, old broken barrels, you name it, all here. No one to this day has dared touch these bottles. I asked the landlord if there is a ghost as well, and he's told me that although he's seen nothing, the chap that runs the pub for him when he's away is terrified of staying alone. He hears footsteps upstairs, voices down here, when of course the pub's closed. And he said, although he enjoys running the pub, he hates staying here alone. On this actual window here, I've noticed that there's actually a slider on the sash that you could lift it, but I'm certainly not going to lift it. And I'm also not going to stand here too long, just in case. In the 12th century, William de Newburgh, a Yorkshire priest, wrote a tale of the wicked Lord of Alnwick. This man died, was buried, and then his body, or his soul, started to fly around the town of Alnwick. His foul smell, they say, spread the great plague around here, and many people died. He was reported as being a vampire. The situation became so serious that many years later his body was exhumed. The coffin lid was removed and his body was said to be still smelling foul and was greatly swollen. Someone struck the body with a spade, and although he'd been dead for many years, he started to bleed. There is another story that he for many years walked around the town, attacking the townsfolk. But luckily, he hasn't been reported for many, many years. Just at the back of me here, the two slits in the wall, directly below the kitchens. And it was just down there, in the tunnels, where the Grey Lady has been seen on many occasions. I'm walking along underneath Alnwick Castle through a tunnel that's not that old actually. Very dark, quite spooky, very cold. It's the story of a Grey Lady, a young girl in Victorian times, a maid, teenager. She fell down the chute, the kitchens are above us, and she fell down this very chute here, where I'm standing, and unfortunately the dumb waiter, the lift that conveyed the food up and down from this tunnel, came down after her and crushed her to death on this very spot where I'm standing now. And they tell me that on frequent occasions people walking along that tunnel have seen the Grey Lady, the ghost of that poor, unfortunate girl that was crushed to death just here, over 120 years ago. I'm now entering the dungeons at Alnwick Castle. During the English Civil War, there were over 6,000 Scottish prisoners imprisoned. Obviously not here in this room, but at the castle. 3,000 of them didn't make it out, died here, and are buried somewhere around here. In here, through this grill, is the pit, or the oubliette, as it was called. And many of those poor unfortunate prisoners were thrown down there into the pit. And they say that even to this day, people can still hear the pathetic moans and groans of those poor dying Scots. I'm in the middle of Durham. I've just descended the stairs from Elvet Bridge that takes you down to Brown's Boathouse, and I'm looking for the old county jail, which I'm told is round here. And I'm looking for the ghost of Jimmy Allen. And would you believe, the old county jail has been turned into a bar and cafe named after the notorious ghost Jimmy Allen. So we'll open the modern doors and go into what was the original county jail of Durham. The old stonework, just as it was, it's rather damp. I would imagine it flooded down here at certain times and probably drowned some of the prisoners. Here, one of the original cell doors, still intact. And on here, through the tunnel, Jimmy Allen was a gypsy piper. He was also a notorious horse thief, and he was imprisoned here in 1810. But he was a very, very old man. And the Prince Regent decreed that he should not be transported to Botany Bay in Australia, as he should have been. They left him here at the jail instead. Inside, they say that there is actually his name scratched on the wall. It just says, Jim. The Prince Regent eventually gave him a royal pardon. But the pardon came through the day after Jimmy died here at the old jail. And the number of people, including a young lady that was just spoken to inside, that said on frequent occasions, they can still hear the skirl of the pipes, because Jimmy Allen was the official piper to the Duchess of Northumbria. And they hear his pipes, but I can't hear him today. All I can hear is modern music. I'm in the centre of Allenmouth, outside the famous Schooner Hotel. This place is reputedly the most haunted hotel in Great Britain. So I think without further ado, we'd better go in and see what we can find. The door creaks, that's a good start. Hi, Karina Appleby, yes, you're the head receptionist.
That's right, yeah, head receptionist of the hotel.
And this is reputedly, as I've just said, the most haunted hotel. Well, why?
Probably because we've got 60 spirits in total, and that's quite a number.
60 for, individual.
Individual, that's right, yeah.
Sightings of ghosts.
No, I'm actually 60 individual spirits sighting.
Wow, haunting total. The building.
Yeah, actually haunting. And
gosh,
the scary thing is, there's only about six downstairs. The rest are. And there's been actually 2,568 sightings to date.
From people involved in the hotel?
Yeah, that's like guests, residents, staff.
That is amazing. And you actually get You've seen something?
Oh, yes, haven't you?
Oh, wow. What about customers? Do they actually write to you afterwards?
You do, yeah. I can give you some comments.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, sure, if you want to have a look. I mean, like I say, you get a lot of people...
So that's actually been sent to you?
Yeah, well, like I say, you get people who send them and who would rather send them than... You
know, hello.
Yeah, sure, of course. And then you get those who actually write while they're here. They'll scribble it down in a wee bit of paper.
So this is from December 2001?
December, yeah.
I stayed at your hotel last weekend with four other friends. You may remember us. Rooms 12, 14 and 14A. We certainly had a scream of a time. It was late one evening, or should I say early morning. I think we were the only five left in the bar. Or we were, until a black-coated figure came gliding past us and disappeared through the wall. Gosh, December the 9th, I was alone in my room. Oh, I won't go any farther with that one.
Yeah.
My goodness me.
Yeah, there's quite a bit. As like I say, there's an awful lot of history links to the hotel. So.
And you've actually been voted...
Favourite haunted hotel of the year, 98 and 2002.
This is the actual certificate by the Poltergeist, the British Poltergeist Society. Wow. Can we... can you show me... Any places that...
Yeah,
that,
I mean, I can take you through the Chase Bar if you want to.
Oh, yes, please. Oh, yeah.
This has got a wee bit of history. The bar itself was actually haunted by Parson Smythe, as a local parson, and he would get casks of ale taken down to his house from the inn.
Right.
And on opening the cask of ale with the tap, that it actually flew off and hit him in the head and actually killed him.
Killed
the parson.
And... You're saying that is the actual tap?
Yeah, sure, of course.
Wow.
That's what I'm saying. And like, it was said by locals in the village, if it was ever returned to a cask of ale again, it would flow with the parson's blood. So...
Nobody's ever tried it, just in case.
It's still there.
And that's real?
Yeah, sure, yeah.
Of course it's real, yes. And isn't it old? And it's still... my goodness.
Yeah.
That is amazing.
So,
And what about anything else in this room?
In this particular area. I mean, we had some incredible... We're going back to 1806 when we had the worst storms, which actually changed the course of the river.
So and, I've heard, yes. Yeah, that's incredible, that is.
Like I say, there was a small inn cutting off around about here. So you just had the front of the hotel. Like I say, it wasn't a hotel, it was a small inn.
Yep.
And a young family. And again, the business, you know, money was not made in a small inn. So the gentleman still had to work at sea. Father worked at sea, young family waiting on him coming home. Now the wee girl, she was in a rocking chair on her mum's lap when her mum jumped up at the sight of the fisherman coming back dead. And the wee girl fell out of her lap, cracked her head off the hearth fire, didn't die from flames. It was actually, she choked in her own blood.
Oh, my, here, on this spot.
This
This was because her father, who was a fisherman, was brought back dead.
He was brought back. He'd actually gone aboard it. Luckily, he'd been rescued, but he was lifeless.
Oh, I say.
And, I mean, I guess it seems something like that. She just...
Oh, yeah. And did they bring him into the inn?
Through the inn. It was...
Oh, I say. And laid him out, I suppose.
I don't know. I don't have the exact details
on
where he was put. But like I say, all concentration was based on him when he came through the doors.
Of course.
And like I say, oblivious to the child she had on her lap, she jumped up.
My goodness.
And there's been an awful lot of sightings for that. She was only six. Her name was Lizzie. She was only 6 years old when she died. And like I say, we had a lady in the conservatory, which is... Well,
through there, yeah.
She'd get straight through.
Right, yeah.
And she was finishing off morning coffee when she heard a girl chattering to herself, as they do, you know, it's small kids.
Yes, yeah.
And she was amused by this. And she finished her coffee and thought she'd go through and talk to the girl. When she came through here, there was the room was as empty as it is now. And there was nobody in here whatsoever. And she could still feel the girl and she could still hear
While she was in here?
Yeah,
with no one else in the room?
Nobody else. It was a Sunday morning, it was very quiet, nothing going on. And finishing her tea, like I say, came through and there we
are. Wow. Now, you say that most of the problems tend to be upstairs.
Oh, yeah, most of them are, yeah. Like I say, there's only, I'd say, half a dozen downstairs and it's mainly based upstairs. Whether that or not is because you get people upstairs and it's dark and it's creepy at night time.
Yeah. Shall we go and have a look?
Yeah, sure.
Thanks very much.
Yeah, great.
And this is, we're right at the top, are we, I presume,
now?
Yeah,
this is the most haunted part of the hotel. Most haunted corridor in the whole hotel.
Up here?
Most haunted rooms, yeah.
Oh, right.
Yeah, just up here.
So, I mean, it's a little bit old to say the least. I mean, the shapes of the doors, for a start, are sloping a little bit. Yeah.
Yeah.
And this is it, here?
Yeah, this is it. This is about as old as you're going to get, and as haunted as you're going to get. Yeah, really.
So people come down in the mornings, I presume?
I guess it's not only that, it's housekeepers who are up here, staff, again, especially residents who... You'll get more reports from this corridor than you would any other. Put it that way.
Really?
Yeah.
And is it that they've come out the room, into the corridor and see it?
No, not necessarily. I mean, it's quite an eerie corridor to begin with.
It's extremely old and rather atmospheric. The old door's still on, you know.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. The most reports are actually from the room, room 30.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
I see. And what goes on in there?
Apparently there was a suicide in there, in that particular room. Right. Now, there was a lady stayed in there for a week. She was on a weekly tour. And every day she saw a figure. Now, she saw a figure from the door, if I can just show you, from the door, around the wall, and out of the window.
Right. And I presume that's what happened, is it? Someone threw themselves out the window, do you think?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't know. Like I say, I'm very unfortunate. I don't have exact details on
but
that.
All but
like
you say, know is that people see things
and,
in
well,
these
that's
rooms.
It's not just actually been one person that's actually cited that. There's actually been quite a few that have actually, without knowing the next person said that, have actually given exactly the same sighting.
So you're building up, if you like, a dossier of reported sightings
well,
that are similar.
Actually, well, yeah, you can actually link a spirit to a room. You know, that sort of thing. You can actually, with a lot of research, which does go on, and a lot of history, you can actually begin to recognise a figure, a person, a character that actually haunts a room that you wouldn't have known before.
Wow.
Yeah, and that room, again, that's room 28.
Yeah.
Now, room 29 seems to be alright. He's stuck in the middle there, and he seems to do alright for himself.
Really?
But room 28, again, there's been a few hauntings actually in that room. Like I say, a figure at the door.
Right.
Just a figure, a dark figure. You can't name it female, male. It just is a tall figure at the door. And like I say, it's a creepy room just to stand here and look at.
Yeah.
But this corridor, I mean, it can be...
It creaks.
You can be in your room watching TV or that room or whatever, and there can be nobody on here that you know of. You know there's nobody here.
And you can hear the footsteps.
And you can even literally open your door and you can still hear. I mean, if you just need to walk, you can hear.
Yeah. Oh, I say, I mean, it's old, it creaks. Old buildings move, we know that.
Yeah,
but
walking along, no, you can actually...
Yeah, you can tell when it's footsteps going along it.
You can still hear. Like I say, if you stood at the door and you're on your... That was one particular report.
Yeah.
She thought there was someone at our door, you know, a chambermaid.
Yeah. Oh, listen to it.
And she opened, there was nobody there, but the creaks were still actually going along the corridor.
Yeah.
So, that, you know, that sort of...
Amazing.
Yeah,
and what about... The depths of the building.
Well, yeah,
have you got any cellars or?
We do. We have one room again that's actually been kept to its age. The old cobble floors,
really?
Stone stairs.
Can we see that?
Yeah, of course.
Oh yes, please.
Sure.
Okay. And the last bit of the tour of the schooner, the bowels of the building, the cellars. Yes.
Yeah, that's right.
Still preserved.
It is. Yeah, it's still there. And,
oh boy.
Intact.
Will you go first?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you. I don't know what to expect, you see. And this is all original, old stone, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. Like I say, it's...
Gosh.
But really, the hotel has been left in its original state.
Right.
It hasn't, as you can see.
Oh, you look at the cobbles.
It hasn't actually been touched at all. It's, like I said, this is still...
This is absolutely incredible. Yeah, I've not seen a cellar like this before.
Yeah, so...
And what about... What's that?
That's actually that's the old tunnel that leads down onto the beach, and that's where we had an awful lot of pirate invasion from.
Yeah, smugglers, of course.
Smugglers, yeah.
Time of the Napoleonic Wars and brandy smuggling, and from France. And
like I said, it goes deeper, further down.
Yeah.
And straight down.
Goes under the road.
Under the road and onto the beach. Yeah.
Well, how far?
The locks are not there anymore. Just.
God. That's amazing. What? Does anything happen here?
No, do you get? Not at the moment. We are actually in the process of making a focal point of this.
Mind you, I suppose nobody comes down here, experience anything.
No, not really. Obviously, when we do our ghost talks, we do bring people down here because it is something that is quite unbelievable.
Yeah, this would be really good, wouldn't it, done up and made into a sort of feature for the hotel.
Or a bistro, or a wine, you know, a trendy wine.
Exactly.
You know, it's just incredible, it really is. And it's just amazing it's stayed intact and so unspoiled.
Yeah, absolutely, it's a treasure.
So it will be made a focal point of the hotel eventually.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
So basically, if you're looking to stay in a haunted hotel in the northeast of England, then it's got to be the old schooner.
Yeah.
Karina, that is fantastic. Thanks very much indeed.
It's a pleasure.
Thank you. I'm standing on the steps of what is reputed to be the most haunted castle in England, Chillingham Castle, 15 miles from Alnwick. I've never seen it before. I'm about to enter through its gateway. And waiting to greet me, David. Hi.
Good afternoon.
Thanks for letting me in. You are, well, amongst other things, guide here at the castle. Well,
I can show you around.
So can you tell me one or two spooky things and a little bit about it?
As many other people that have stayed here could tell you as well.
That's wonderful. Right, let's go in and have a look. Well, first impressions. It's spooky. It really is incredible, isn't it? It's unlike so many other sort of stately homes that you see that are all, for want of a better word, dolled up. This is
genuine,
isn't it? Yeah.
It looks better when it's dark with the torches lit on the walls.
Oh, I can imagine.
It's more eerie then.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, are there ghosts here?
There are ghosts. It is not a publicity stunt. Many people think we're talking a load of rubbish, but so many people have experienced things here that you can't dispute everyone.
Of course not. Have you seen anything?
I've seen two.
Really?
Both ladies. Oh. One outside the lodge where I live.
Yeah.
And one night a lady was knelt by the side of my bed praying, and she just faded away when I was watching her.
So, yeah, but you see, seeing's believing. And it changes your attitude, don't you think?
Yes, because I wasn't sure that I believed in things like this.
Until you came here.
When you've seen it, you can't dispute it. And the number of people that have stayed here, and they've told the same thing months and months apart, you can't dispute everyone.
Exactly. You end up by sort of making a list up of sightings, and when they start to be similar, then you realise that those people haven't liased about it. Mm-hmm. So it must be true.
Yes.
Now people can actually stay here, can't they?
We have self-contained apartments. They do their own catering and they sleep here, spend the days where they want to, in the grounds or go in different areas.
And look for ghosts.
And the main one is the Grey apartment right above us.
Right.
So many people have heard, experienced the same things there. The number of people that have stayed in the Grey apartment, on the next morning they've come down and asked the staff to tell the people in the apartment above them to be quieter during the night. They said they were moving furniture during the night, and when it's pointed out that the only thing above them is a roof, they're a little bit amazed.
I can imagine. Do they stay another night?
Yes, they do.
I'm surprised. Can we go and have a look up there?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, that way or?
Yeah.
And look at the size of that key! Wow! And this is one of the apartments, the Grey apartment. And you can actually hire this out. You can stay here.
Yes.
Oh, yes. I shall be booking in. And so it's literally, the roof is above us. So there are no rooms. In fact, I can see.
The bedrooms are to the end there. Just the roof above us here. And so many people have said people have been moving furniture in the apartment above, and
it's not possible
because there's no apartment above us.
So that's obviously poltergeist activity that's going on, but things have been seen here in the castle as well.
There's not that I've seen it, but several people a long time back said that there's one lady that used to walk out of a picture. Well, the painting was of a lady who lived here years ago, and her husband ran away with her sister.
Oh my gosh.
And she committed suicide.
At the castle?
And, as I believe, yes.
Yeah.
And several people said she used to walk out of her picture. That I did find a little bit hard to believe.
Yeah.
But having seen two ladies myself...
Then anything's possible.
That you can't... You think differently.
Yeah, exactly. And what about this little boy?
Well, when they were removing a fireplace in one of the rooms here, they found the skeleton of a young boy.
Yeah.
And no one knew who he was or why he was there. And there was a fragment of blue material, so they called him the Blue Boy.
Of course. That was another part of his clothing, possibly.
Yes. But they had his remains laid to rest religiously. Mm-hmm. So.
And has he stopped haunting?
He's not reported to have been seen.
Crikey. And then there's another one. What about this room that was found by workmen in the 1900s, I think? Something about they opened up a room and there was supposedly a man sitting at a table, and the room was airtight, And as they opened the door, of course, the air went in, and they watched this man actually
disintegrate,
yes. Literally, apparently, and all that was left sitting on the chair was a skeleton.
Yes.
Which is again, but again, when you think things are like that are happening, obviously these people are like the little boy, bricked up, yes, in the fireplace for whatever reason, the man sealed off in the room, all this torment,
yes,
premature death, you see, and all this sort of thing, yes, I presume is the reason that causes, I want so many manifestations here, I would think.
Well, and we have the dungeon where they used to lock them and just leave them with no food, no water, and there was a hole in the floor. And
that was it?
At the end of it, they went down the hall.
Oh, my God.
The castle was surrounded many years ago with a moat. So I presume the
bottom through the hole
fell into the moat, and...
Oh, my gosh.
That was the end of it.
Can we see? Is the dungeon around to see? We are. Yes. Let's go and have a look.
The floor is rather uneven in here, and it's quite narrow.
Okay, and this leads us into the dungeon.
Into the dungeon.
Okay. Now that is a door. My goodness me. Not a lot of room. Oh, I say. There's a distinct chill in here. Oh, there would be, because there's a hole, but...
there's a slot in there. When the draught comes in, people were just shut in here, left without any food or water.
Yeah.
Until the end came.
Oh, my gosh. And then what?
Hole in the floor, the moat all around the castle.
Yeah.
And
so they were dropped through when they were no longer of any use, yeah, dead.
I presume...
Oh, my gosh.
I presume years ago there wouldn't have been a grill there.
No, of course not.
Just a hole.
Yeah.
And when they died...
Oh, my goodness.
Presumably, they were just pushed down there.
Yeah. And on the walls, scratchings of the prisoners? Graffiti from hundreds of years ago.
And they tried to work out how long they'd
been. Oh, yes, the lines look... I wonder whether that was days, weeks, or years that they were in here.
I doubt if it was years.
I doubt it very much. I would think in a place like this, it'd probably be days. That is absolutely incredible. And from dungeon to torture chamber. And there are some dreadful, dreadful pieces of equipment in here. It's quite frightening to think what mankind does to its fellow man when you look at these dreadful things. Gibbets, iron maidens, thumbscrews, man traps. Am I right in assuming that this is the room that was used during the film, Elizabeth?
Elizabeth, yes. This was actually her bedroom in the film. Well, obviously, all the equipment was taken out.
Of course.
But this was her bedroom, and that was put in for the film.
Wow. Amazing. So really, truly, obviously this was removed. I wonder if the actors and actresses realised that they were actually filming in an old torture chamber.
I don't know.
But when you think about it, with all this torture, death and torment that must have gone on here, no wonder this castle is the most haunted castle in England. You really won't find many more bleak, exposed spots than this anywhere in England. I'm standing on the highest point of an old drover's road. This is a Saxon cross that marks the point very close to Otterburn. Down below is the village of Elsdon. But above me here is Winter's Gibbet. In 1791, William Winter, aided by two gypsies, murdered an old lady called Margaret Crozier in Elsdon. He was sentenced to be hanged at Newcastle. Public opinion was very high, and before he was hanged, he was measured for his last suit in the condemned cell. He was measured by the blacksmith, because the blacksmith made him a gibbet cage for him to be hung up here. He was hanged until he was dead, taken down and before he was put into his coffin, the body was tarred to preserve it. He was loaded into a cart and brought up here to this high point, overlooking the cottage where Margaret lived. And they hung him up 30 feet high in a gibbet cage and left him to rot, left him for the crows to pick at his flesh and his eyes. And after many years, the bones dropped out of the cage and he was buried. It was customary for the bones to be buried beneath the gibbet. But they don't think this happened here, because about 100 yards away from this spot is a gateway with a cattle grid on the road. And that is where the ghost of William Winter has been seen on many occasions, standing by the side of the road, longingly looking back towards his gibbet post. Hello, my name's Richard Felix, and I'm here at my base at the Old County Jail in the centre of Derby. This place over the last 150 years has been a place of terror, torment, and of course death. And that's one of the reasons why this place is as haunted as it is. I've chosen Derby as the catalyst for the national ghost tour of Great Britain. Over the last 10 years, I have taken in excess of 95,000 people on a ghost tour somewhere around the Midlands. And of course, have spoken to many of those people on the tours, and of course have realised just how fascinated people are by ghosts. This is the reason that we have chosen to do this tour. The video that you've just watched is a part of that series, but I want your help. If you have a ghost story, then please either email me or write to me at the address that you'll see at the end of this video. Of course, you must remember that after speaking to so many people, I think I have an ability to be able to see through some of the stories, to be able to differentiate between a story that is true or a story that's made up. And of course, you must remember that 8 out of 10 ghost stories can be explained. But it's the other two that you've got to worry about. I hope you've enjoyed the video. Do sleep well, and don't have nightmares.